Michelle, the stage is yours.
So, sorry, an introduction to Ansible. I presume everybody knows already the basics, but I'll go over some other things also. So first, who am I? I'm a consultant. I live in Antwerp, Belgium. I like to do stuff with CentOS and with virtualization. I do mostly Ansible and a little bit of Puppet because customers insist that we use it. And yeah, I have a Twitter handle and a blog, but you won't find much on it. So what is Ansible? What can you do with it? How do you get started? I give my example of how to create a virtual machine, which is what I typically do with it. You can do much more with it, of course. So Ansible is a configuration management tool, an orchestration management tool, a remote execution tool. It can convert all your bash scripts to YAML, so all your managers can read it. It's a tool which can actually automate U of A, but we don't like saying that. It's written in Python. You don't need to necessarily know Python unless you want to develop modules. On the node that you want to run Ansible, it is useful to have Python, because then you can run the modules and use all the extended features. It's not a requirement. You can run it in what is called roam mode, which basically executes a command on the host. You use some of the functionality like the idempotency. It's server-based, so there's no agent required, but you need to have a transport layer. For the normal people, that's SSH. For Windows people, that's WinRM. You have your host information coming from by default from a flat file. You have an ini file which basically describes your inventory list. If that file would be a script, then Ansible will automatically execute that script, and as long as it gets the values in JSON, it will be able to handle all those hosts from your central database. It typically executes a specific task on the node, and those tasks we combine in playbooks. Playbooks typically are combined in roles, which are an abstraction layer for playbooks. So they're typically more generic, and they should be reusable. Playbook is written in YAML. JSON is supported, but in the newer versions, it's preferred to stick to YAML only. If you have very complex things, you might still want to use JSON, but nowadays, if you want to get it on Galaxy or on any other thing, then it is advisable to stick to YAML. Templates are created in Jinja 2. It's a templating engine typically used by Python programs. Yes, and it works where Python works. So in typical use cases, if you don't have Python, like on Unix machines, you can actually bootstrap it, install Python, and then run the full module set on it. It requires a minimum of Python 2.4. It prefers Python 2.6 or higher. And there are efforts being done to change to Python 3.
Excuse me,
slight correction.
Ansible 2.4 currently requires Python 2.6.
It's
required?
Yes. Okay. So apparently 2.4 has been dropped.
Yes.
Okay.
In 2.4.
Yeah, I didn't know that. Well, I read that a lot of things changed, but I didn't pay attention on that. Okay. So internally, Well, the design looks something like this, which basically is your management node, which is listed here. You have Ansible running there with Python. It will use or Paramico or SSH, that depends on how you've configured it, and will then connect using that layer to the app server, well, to your nodes. This is still an old layout, so you still see 0 and 2 that has been dropped a long time ago. And you can have execute plugins which are callbacks, which can then send you an email, do logging, allow you to report back to an external system. Typically, you will use it in the ad hoc mode, which means that you have a machine where you have Ansible completely installed, which is normally called the management node. You will get all your hosts from the flat files or from your CMDB. You'll have your playbooks there. It will actually compile all of this and send it to the node and execute it there. It can do that in parallel. So typically, I think by default, it creates Firefox and runs on 5 machines at the same time. You can increase or decrease that depending on your requirements. There's also something called delegation mode, whereby you would, in place of talking to the normal nodes, talk to a different node, your load balancer, your monitoring tool, any other node you need to actually talk to execute that play. Then there is a pull method. I don't think many people use it. I've not heard many people using it. But that requires that you can actually, well, that requires that you have on all the nodes Ansible. Ansible would at that point look at a central master, get all the configuration from there, and then execute it locally.
Just to satisfy Chris.
Sorry?
Just to make sure that Chris also can use Ansible.
No, he uses Puppet to execute Ansible and not the way around. The idea here was that you could actually have Ansible running locally, have a cron job do it, which will check it, similar to what Puppet does. But in a normal use case for what Ansible is meant, you wouldn't want to set it up like this. So to get started, you actually git clone Ansible, and then you have the code. Then you need to actually create a host inventory, which is typically an ini file. The rectangular brackets are group names, and then your host is the name main here, for instance. And then if you don't have DNS set up, or if your naming and your DNS is different, you can actually have each thing specified. This is still an old syntax. So in the new syntax, it's just Ansible underscore host. The SSH has been taken out to be able to support Windows also. The port is the same thing, user. For the private key, you still need an SSH over there.
For Windows, it still asks for an SSH password.
So
we haven't taken it out completely.
Yes, but it's listed as SSH password, but it actually means the WinRM password.
But they haven't removed the SSH completely.
No. On some places they haven't done that, mostly because the use cases where it is used for Windows, it uses certificate-based authentication, so nobody's actually patched that. And then you have typically also 2 folders, host underscore vars and group underscore vars, which have YAML based files where you can define variables for each specific host or a group. If you prefer to have it as a script, you could actually have a script execute, so it just looks at the shebang on the top and will execute the script. In this case, it just has a little SQLite database where it will get it out and will print it in JSON. JP, that would.
Is that inventory syntax? What spit out there? Have you tested that? I mean, you know, script is awesome, of course, but if the JSON that comes out of there.
Depends on what.
That's not JSON. But it's not inventory JSON.
It will only give you one value. Select count gives you one value only.
Yeah, you don't get a host name.
No. You don't get.
you get nothing except one value.
Why don't you just skip to the next slide?
Yeah.
So
I have an example that actually works.
Okay. You have a bunch of modules. This was taken in 2013, so they're quite old. If you go now to the list of modules, it would be a few slides. So, but basically, most of the modules are quite standard, and they have a whole bunch of arguments, are today very well documented. So if you have any problems, you can actually use Ansible Doc and get the full documentation of that module. The only ones which are sometimes a little bit tricky are the command and the raw ones, where you execute things which are not idempotent. So if you make mistakes there, yes, Ansible will not help you. It will allow you to do stupid things. With most of the other ones, there are fail-safes in there, and many of them have been extensively discussed already. So typically, if you want to run a single task, you can run just Ansible all, which will go to all the hosts that are in your inventory, and run the module called ping, which basically gives you a pong back, showing that it's reachable. If you run the second one, the setup module, it does fact gathering, so it will give you all the information it has of that host back. If you want to run a little bit more complicated commands, you can use command, which drops down to the shell level, or you could actually install something specifically on it. So typically, you don't use this that much, the setup or the ping, to just check whether you can get to the host, and then you would actually use a playbook. Playbook is a YAML definition of the actions that you will do. So on the top, you start with the three lines, which indicate that it's a YAML file. Then you describe which hosts it should apply to. And you can set variables for a playbook as what user it should run. The sudo has changed to become. The sudo still works, but it's preferred to use become. The serial file basically tells that this playbook can run on 5 nodes at the same time. So if you would have like hundreds of them, it would do in groups of 5. And then it runs the task. The task typically has a name. You see it's an older presentation because the action word is taken out. So typically today you would have just command, double point, and then the command behind it.
Then just in the defense of Toshan, because it's an old presentation, I asked him at about 7 o'clock this morning if he would like to do this one, so he didn't have time to really prepare. Just in your defense, Toshan.
Well, I haven't changed all my playbooks to the new syntax.
No,
they keep on working.
You just get more deprecation warnings.
You can put those off, even.
Have you upgraded from CentOS 2 anymore?
I run on the belt, so...
He's got a Red Hat version 2.
Is there a connection between the serial number and the number of ports?
Sorry,
the
serial
ports? Serial?
Yeah, so the FOX is the maximum it will do, and with serial you can override that. But you cannot go higher than the number of FOX you have.
Okay.
So if you put FOX on 1 and you put serial on 5, it will still do only 1.
Okay.
So tasks are typically a name, what it's supposed to do, and then the delegate to basically can tell that in place of the host that you are contacting through the playbook, I would like to contact a different host. So in this example, you would typically tell your load balancer to take it out of the pool, then upgrade your web server, make sure that it's running. Once you know it's running, put it back in the load balancer. Now, if you're going to change something like the template here, then you can have something called a notifier, which basically will see if the state has changed and will then execute a task called a handler, which is defined here at the bottom. So you say if if that template file changes, then only restart Apache. If you see that nothing has changed, then it won't execute that part of the task. Roles are an abstraction layer, so in this example of the playbook, you actually are writing the whole playbook with all the tasks in there. Typically, today you would create an abstraction layer, so something like a database can be defined, or some other specific thing, which means that you will actually create the roles which are mentioned here. And then the tasks, you can have still pre-tasks and post-tasks so that you can actually have things run separately. Templates are in Jinja 2. They typically have a lot of curly brackets for the variables. Any variable you see that starts with Ansible underscore comes from Ansible itself, except one which is the inventory host name that doesn't have an Ansible in front of it. So this would basically give you the variable Ansible managed, which is a string you can put in your configuration, which will say that yes, this file is being managed by Ansible and was created on this date by this user. And then it will actually just put here the, well, we'll actually template this file and insert the variable edit mode and put it on your node. That doesn't exist anymore. Given that Ansible is written in Python and it was designed as an executable API, it means that you can actually run the commands that you run on the command line very similarly in the API. So that has changed.
It doesn't work anymore.
Okay.
There is still a Python runner, but it's and you can embed Ansible, but it's massively more complicated than that example that I have.
But this used to work. Used to. Okay.
With Ansible 1.0, I think.
Yeah. Presentation was written for one something. Yeah. So, in my case, I built virtual machines from Ansible. I have a host definition. So in my case, I have very long and big descriptions of the virtual machines. In this case, for instance, it will set a variable called hyper with a specific distribution and a root password where the queue images need to be placed. What type of networking is required, what type of partitions need to be made, and the user at the bottom so I can SSH into the machine if required. So looking at some of the examples, you have your inventory, your host files, which is basically all the definitions of the names. In my case, I put host names like this. So for instance, if you look at the monitoring systems, there are two of them in there, and then if you go to host files, you will actually see them written down there. I've changed most of them to YAML, not yet everything, but it basically tells you on which host, where the host is, which port to connect to, what is the user, on which hypervisor, what distribution, and so on and so on. So it's a lot of variables which get set. Here, for instance, are a variable set for Isinga because it's a monitoring machine, and it will use this in its role. So you have a playbook which is basically nothing more than just saying that it needs to run on all hosts, because it will actually set up the masters, the zones, the clients, and then it will run the Isingatoo role. A role is set up of something called files, handlers, tasks, templates, and vars, which are basically the composition of a playbook. So if you look at tasks, you will have a main.yaml which defines certain actions that need to be done. So you can use a when to make sure that if this variable is defined and it is in a zone, that it will execute a specific subtask. So in this case it's master. So in this case it will actually execute this. So it will make sure that it executes yum and installs the latest packages. Then you can have a whole set of items. Yum is a little bit special because it will not do each one separately. It will actually try to combine all of those and make sure that they are installed. There are a few tricks on many of the package management systems to actually do this a little bit quicker, because otherwise it would have to run yum for each item. So it uses some additional logic. If you look at things like here, the command, it will actually run this one time with idle psql and one time with graphite, because there's no additional logic to combine them together.
And you said yum does combine them?
Yes, yum combines them and will actually run with all the items in there at one time.
And there is also untold package and apts. They also combine.
They do it for apts, yum, DNF.
Okay.
I don't know about the other ones, to be honest.
And is it the one transaction?
It's one transaction.
So one package is not there, the whole transaction fails?
Obviously. And that is what the package manager also does. Because if you do that, you get on your package manager that this dependency failed because of this. So they give you exactly the same information back. In nice red color, that's about it. you can do things like this. So you can even have within your items definitions of names, so that you can actually have here the item source and the item destination. So you see I've rewritten some of it, but not everything, because I still have some with action in there. You can have specific variables set per role, which basically are variables which get loaded into specific roles at that point. Then you don't need to set them on the host level. If you would run. If you would just run the setup module on a specific node, if internet is working, it should give you all the facts of that machine. So these facts you can then embed into your playbook. So if you need to know which networking card it is, or if you want to even get the MAC addresses of cards. Okay. You could get the MAC address of a specific card in there. If you execute a playbook, let's see which one I can do. Thank you. It will tell you what the tasks are. Yeah, I have calcium. It will tell you what the tasks are, and it will actually give you whether the state got changed or not. And it will, if a specific class does not apply to that host, it will actually tell you that it skipped that. So here you see skipped because it's not applicable in this case. So if it sees that something is not applicable, it can do. In this case, it has even cleaned up some files, so the state has changed there. If it's green, it means it's okay. That means it was already in the correct state. And at the end, it gives you what changed in total. Well, what was okay already, how many things changed. If it was unreachable, it will tell you that. Or if a specific play failed, it will tell you that. Typically, if a play fails or an action fails, it will actually stop the complete playbook. You can have that if this task is not very important, you can say ignore the error and continue on.
It fails if all the hosts have failed, then the playbook will stop. But if only one host fails,
then it
continues.
Will continue on all the other hosts.
But there is an option, it's a recent option that tells you that you can state that if any task fails for whatever reason on a specific host, it should fail everything, if that's your need.
Well, so I think you can put that in
or a certain percentage of host fails.
That's also a possibility.
Yeah.
Percentage you can also
put?
Yes.
So in the .ansible.cfg, you can actually put that, I think, somewhere. Any errors fatal?
Yeah.
So you could set that specifically.
But you can also put it in the playbook for a specific play.
Yeah.
And that's just because sometimes you have this need.
So in this .ansible.cfg, you can set up the specific variables that you want. So how many forks there are 15. How long a poll interval should be by default. At the bottom, there is also the SSH. Yeah. So what SSH connection, whether it should use pipelining, whether it should use the SCP in place of SFTP protocol. Where the control paths and directory is for persistent connections. If you prefer to use Paramico, you can set it up with Paramico also.
Why would you use SCP in this case? Why did you enable this?
Because
legacy network police.
No, there are.
Because SCP is a lot. It has more overhead and it's more likely to fail.
Yes, it's more overhead. It's not more likely to fail, but
it's using the shell. Right?
Yeah, it's using shell.
So it's.
So, but I think it was. Yeah, it was the time when I was working with a customer with AIX, and they don't have FTP in there. So, and anyway, you will install OpenSSH clients on most of your machines anyway, so you have SCP.
Don't do this at home.
You can do fact caching in memory, or you can also use Redis databases there. So the squash actions are actually applicable on all these commands, which means that you will use all the with items and squash them together in one transaction. Mostly it is done
for the whole play.
No, that's for that one action. So that's mostly for packet manager, because packet managers typically can have multiple arguments as there. If you would write your own module, you could add it there. I don't think there are other ones that you could use there. You can have deprecation warnings off or on. You can have even command warnings. So typically it is considered bad to use command because there should be a module for it. The most use cases is if Python is not installed, then you will install Python so you can use the module. You could actually say, I don't want to see all the skipped hosts. this is the Ansible managed, so this is what will come on the top, well, on the variable where you define it. Which is the default remote user you want to use it, which is the shell you want. Host key checking is based on the fact whether you want to actually do SSH host key checking, which is the default transport method, which is the default port. I think by default the transport is smart, so it will try to figure out which is the best way to do it. So it's quite simple to do it, and any questions?
What was that option to stop the whole playbook at one host case?
All errors fatal. Any errors fatal. Yeah, there's documentation, it's great.
This one. Oh yeah, maybe for this. So which is a module?
Minel.
Yeah. So this will basically tell you the module yum, and tells you what it does, which arguments it has, and what the arguments actually need to be filled in. And you can thank JP for that.
Well, actually, if I recall correctly, Tom and I had the idea.
Yeah, we had the idea. So you typed it in.
I believe I implemented at least most of it, but yeah. And it's turned out, at least for me, to be very, very
helpful. Yeah, and it's an idea that comes from Puppet Doc.
Well, it's a very useful thing because you can do this offline. So if you're in a corporate environment and you don't remember an argument, typically you would go to the website. If you have no internet because they don't allow public internet, then you can still find all these things here. They even give you the examples, which is exactly the same output you get on the website.
Another great thing about it is that you can look up all the stuff that's available in the version that you are using.
Yeah.
Yes, exactly.
Ansible doc.
Ansible. Oh, yeah. There's only minus L, you get a list of all the
All the available modules. Ansible doc. One thing I miss is that the Ansible language itself is not explained in the doc.
What do you mean?
Don't look at me.
No. What do you mean by the language? All modules are explained, not the language itself or the configuration files.
You mean like for loops and things like that?
Yeah.
No,
so that's not what you need to know.
It's on the website.
It's a good remark.
It's a very valid point. The original intention of this was to design and to invent a system by which we could mainly or principally provide module documentation. So the author writes the documentation in the module, and Ansible doc. Which, by the way, is horrendously slow. If you do Ansible doc minus L, it takes ages because it goes through 2,000 modules.
Yeah.
It has to parse them in Python and bring out the documentation. So that part is very slow. That was the original intention. And there was no provision, to be honest, I certainly didn't think of it. There was no provision to actually also document the language itself and all the capabilities of YAML, etc. But a very valid point. I expect a pull request from you for, let's say, tomorrow evening.
One thing is, when you are trying to do your exam, you might sometimes forget some keywords or so, and then you are crazy looking about what did I didn't remember, because you don't have internet during your exam. So is it
the full documentation available?
Oh, okay, that's something I didn't know. So. But this is very valuable for the documentation for the module. So, thank you.
Open an issue at least with the remark, because I think it's valid and you should look at the
product. I also gave to Maxime from Red Hat.
I think an issue will be
okay.
Solved. Yeah.
Any other questions, remarks?
I was wondering about the validation. In a way, I do this. When you do that, then you use something like Yelp. It's going to lock every installation on the system, isn't it? So, how is it going to do validation if it's...
It basically takes all the arguments and puts it behind Yum.
Yeah.
Because Yum by default can handle that. It runs
okay.
As Yum install minus Y with all the arguments behind them, put them online, and then it runs that.
So there'll be one argument on this.
Yeah, there's the squashing part. Huh? So it takes all the bit items and squashes them together in one big command. But of course, the command itself needs to be able to handle that. So in this case, Yum can do it, apt can do it, there were a few other ones that can do it. Yes, but
can you go back to a slide where you have some actions? Like this. If you look at your code style, you have a sort of a code style where you name every action, that's good, and then you use action instead of the module as the first parameter.
Yes, this is the old style.
A format with a package equals yeah. HTTP. And if you look at tools like Ansible Lint or Ansible Review,
it will fail, yeah.
Then
I know.
It will say, okay, you can
this,
rather.
This was written
sort of
in 2013.
That, yeah.
And these are the ones that I use now.
Oh, sorry, that was.
Yeah, and in you weren't here.
Yeah.
When I defended Toshan, I asked him at 7 o'clock this morning to do a presentation because somebody
canceled.
So
I have rewritten some of them in the meanwhile
to the
to the new convention, even though I still don't like this, but that's different.
Yeah.
But okay, this has evolved.
So there are reasons why we still allow the old convention, because if you use the Ansible command for running ad hoc commands, you still need to have the old convention because you cannot specify a YAML on the command line. And so we still need to support the old convention, and there are some differences between how the old convention works in giving values to variables, because you cannot.
Yeah.
It's very difficult to give a list on a one-line string. So there are differences in how Ansible handles these. So lists, you have to use commas. So if you have a string with a comma in it, it might interpret it as a list. So the old format is probably not the best to use, but in some cases you still have to be able to use it. That's why we cannot remove it from Ansible.
But there was also one reason, I don't know, remember to use the action.
Well, there is another problem.
To do with the API or
something. There is another problem, and that's why I was personally against removing action, because in YAML, in YAML you have a unique key value, it's a dictionary, and internally the yum keyword is actually replaced by action and then module name yum, and it's much more easy because you know what the action is. In this case you have to know that yum in this case is a module, and there is nothing that tells you that in this task yum is the module name. And so there is a namespace conflict, because if you would like to create a module named name or something else, some other reserved keyword, it will fail because it's a reserved keyword and it's not a module. And so, yeah, I don't think it's very well done in this way, but it's convenient. And sometimes convenience is taken over strings.
So, and if you're Orthodox, then you
against it is not correct. Blood flowing.
Well, the thing was, everybody accepted it for convenience, and then I made the remark that I didn't like it, and I gave the argumentation, and then more people were convinced that they didn't like it either, but Michael already decided.
I seem to recall that both you and I preferred the old form of the action.
Yeah. But it's how it is.
It's
so,
so that's why I've started adjusting it. Now finally, this playbook I actually changed for the conference I was at. And you see still there, I've forgotten to take it out, because if you go down here, there's still some with action in there and so on.
But you can still use action with the new form. So you can still do action column, and then I think it's module underscore name, or module...
Module column,
that's it, yeah. It's more typing, so it's less convenient.
Yeah, okay, but...
It's, you know...
It's
But I'm not converted, right?
No. The main problem for me is if you have very complicated with items, or if you have things which have commas and other variables in it, you need to now be very careful and put like with items has to be within the what's it called? The
moustache.
No, not the moustache. The this. So it needs to be typically written as a string. Before you could actually do this.
Yeah.
This will fail today.
Yeah.
But this will always fail because the YAML parser is the first thing that reads your playbook, and the YAML parser doesn't allow it, and so it will.
Before it used to work, you could actually have like this here. This works,
see,
source item, and
it
item
works there because for
middle.
YAML this is a string.
Yeah.
It, because
so it never
middle.
Worked for YAML and for Ansible. It never worked if you started a value with braces.
It will be a dictionary in YAML.
Yeah.
YAML would think it's a dictionary,
yeah.
It's an
and then it will fail.
YAML. And that's unfortunate. We can't fix that.
No,
it's
okay, but
an advantage, because if you have large playbooks and you want to do code quality tooling, then you can do a YAML lid, which is much faster than an Ansible lid.
The problem...
And it will catch these kind of things.
Yeah, the problem with YAML lid in this case, or with any checker, would be that it doesn't know what is a module unless it knows all your module names if you don't use action. And that's my base. Yeah.
You guys are scaring the shit out of any beginners who are here.
Yeah. Are there any beginners here?
Are there beginners here?
Yeah.
No.
Let's use Bob. It's fine.
But if you're interested in these name value things, I had a presentation last year about, what was it called? Where I talked about all the ugly stuff in Ansible that is actually either it evolved into becoming something ugly, or we can't really fix it. And one of the things I mentioned was the combination with Jinja and in YAML, the combination like dictionary, the curly braces, it's something that we cannot fix. And one of the issues is also the fact that everything is considered a string. And there is a way to typecast it when you use a value, but it's ugly. It's
ugly.
I mentioned we cannot fix it because it's how Jinja does stuff. Yeah, this is
how
Jinja does stuff.
Yeah, that's how Jinja,
but
you have to make a choice.
I can tell you that Jinja, that we fixed it, that Ansible fixed it in Jinja in the sense that we created a different way to invoke Jinja with native, it's called native environment, but it's native typing. And this will be in the next version of Ansible, if you enable it specifically. In the version 2.6, it will be enabled by default.
And is it time to go for Jinja 3 or so?
You have to upgrade your Jinja, but I think it's 2.8 or something. I don't know exactly what the version is. But the nice thing is that an integer, if you specify it in YAML, in a playbook that it's an integer, it will be an integer if you use it. You don't have to specifically cast it to an integer at the moment you use it. Which is nice, because it's very difficult to know where you use something and where you simply put a value in.
Yeah, but Python does the same thing. I mean, if you create a value, it doesn't type it.
In Jinja, it's always a string. It used to be always a string, and that's it.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's hard. As a templating engine, it doesn't really matter, but... Well, we're not based.
Hey, okay. For the beginners, I apologize for this.
Any other questions?
Every tool has those.
Okay.
I guess it's because we started using standards. Tooling or standard libraries like YAML and Jinja, and we didn't. If we had created our own templating engine, which would have been hell, and we would have made much worse mistakes, then we could have prevented it. We probably not, but we could have.
if it's used to use the YAML, you should stick to the YAML string.
Yeah, but then you still need the templating engine?
Yeah. Well, done, yeah. Well, I would like to thank you, and the guys are there. Guys and girls of Red Hat supplied me with some special swag for the presenters.
Oh, this one is for you.
Thank you very much. And thank you for the very, very short time that you did it.